This first picture is really my first understanding of exploration and discovery. As early as I can remember, my mother would take me on nature walks behind our house in the South Shore of Massachusetts. Each day, we would go in the back of the woods, and at each step, there was discovery. I can clearly remember these days of going under the leaf litter and finding lady slippers or flowering Indian peace pipes or an old fox skull. These days of discovery have stayed with me. This sense that the forest was a place of spiritual communion has also stayed with me. My mother's sense of awe at each thing that we would find that was extraordinary really was contagious, and it instilled in me this lesson that I carry with me today. That the definition of extraordinary is just that. It's finding something ordinary, but somehow elevated in meaning. And it started with really this ephemeral bloom of a lady slipper. In the third grade, I was asked to do a project on an animal. And as I flipped through the Encyclopedia of Animals, I came across the ring-tailed lemur. I completely fell in love. I told my family that I was moving to Madagascar, and they all laughed at me. But it really was then that I began this lifelong commitment to a place that was so far from home, but so close to my heart. And I did research for this project. I went to our local library, and I came across this National Geographic issue from 1988. And I can remember plopping myself down on a beanbag chair and reading through this issue, Lemurs on the Edge of Survival. It created in me this sense of urgency, this sense of passion, this sense of purpose, that I needed to go to Madagascar and protect lemurs from this very certain fate of endangerment, of extinction. A few years later, in this same library, I came across a book called The Aye and I, written by Gerald Durrell. I read through this voraciously. It became my favorite book, and in many ways, it still is. Gerald Durrell became my hero. He was a naturalist that was dedicated to saving animals in peril, and he had a very special place in his heart for Madagascar. He's known as saying, "The world is as delicate and as complicated as a spider's web. If you touch one thread, you send shudders running through all of the other threads. And we're not just tearing the web, we're really tearing great holes in it." And so I really began to dedicate myself to finding a way to go to Madagascar. I wanted to write a letter to Gerald Durrell, and I sent him a letter right after I read the book and told him how much that book meant to me. A few months later, I got a letter back from his wife telling me that Jerry had passed. And that really propelled me even more to really start my career and find a way to get to Madagascar. And as you can tell from the story, I did find my way to Madagascar. And I just met Lee Durrell, his wife, last year there. I've now spent the past 15 years there. First doing this carnivore behavioral biology research, then starting my own environmental education initiative. And before my senior year in college, I decided to be intrepid and start off my own project in the northeast of Madagascar where Jerry worked. And this is what I found. This picture is incredibly disturbing. This picture still haunts me to this day, and yet I've come to understand it. This is a far cry from the image that I had in my head from reading Jerry's book, and yet it was so important for me to really understand what this image meant. I did the first research creating a systematic survey of hunting in Madagascar that started 10 years ago. We've now monitored this population for the past 10 years, really looking at their reliance on local wildlife. It was the first systematic survey. Madagascar's paradigm has always been that the island was on fire and that slash and burn was destroying the forest. And yet there was a more hidden threat crippling the wildlife populations in Madagascar. It was this undercover threat of hunting, and no one had explored this before. And so I set out to do that. In addition to the wildlife surveys, I initiated a kind of project to look at a lot of the lemur populations and how hunting was occurring. And I just want to send a special thank you to John Betts, who's hopefully here. He's a National Geographic photographer who came out to visit me a few months ago in Madagascar, and the next series of images are all his. So in addition to the hunting surveys, we set up ways of training local Malagasy, training Malagasy University students to monitor their own wildlife. We did this in both diurnal and nocturnal surveys. We wanted to understand the ways in which hunting, and I was very unidirectionally focused looking at how hunting impacted these wildlife population dynamics. And not just lemurs, but the tenrecs. These are like little hedgehogs. We set up a marker capture project to look at population dynamics. We attached radio transmitters to their back to follow them and understand their range and to understand the ways in which their life history was affected by hunting. But all of this wildlife, albeit beautiful, exotic, extraordinary, was reduced by local people to one thing: food. All of it was food. And as I spent year after year in these communities, and as I learned all of their local languages, I came to realize that I needed to look through the forest in their eyes. And it all became clear to me. These people weren't criminals, although they were. Most of the hunting in Madagascar is illegal. But these men were family men. They were providers. They were protecting their family's welfare. So what I set out to do was to start a research team, and locally we called ourselves Maheri, which means strength in the Malagasy language. It also is an acronym that stands for Madagascar's Health and Environmental Research. And in 2008, our team did a systematic survey of how wildlife was connected to human nutrition. We found that if the local communities lost access to wildlife, their rates of anemia would actually increase by 30%. These results were astounding. It really taught us that if local people messed with their natural environment, they were actually self-depleting their own nutritional resource. It was this direct linkage between environmental change and human well-being. It also taught me that if you mess with Mother Nature, she might stop taking care of all of her children. And so for the past 15 months, what ended last month, we decided to study this phenomenon in earnest through support from the Rockefeller Foundation. We enrolled 700 people into our study, and on a daily basis over these 15 months, we measured everything that they were eating in their diet. And every 4 months, we took a blood sample, we took fecal samples, fingernail samples, so that we could understand the ways in which all of these things that are coming from the forest were providing nutritional benefits to them. From the fecal samples, looking at the ways in which intestinal parasites affected nutrition, how dietary intake and pharmaceutical use affected their microbiome. I wanted to stop having tunnel vision, stop looking at only the ways in which humans were affecting the environment, but also the ways in which the environment circled back and could benefit humans, to reframe the conversation of conservation. Not only were we looking at nutrition and food security, we were also looking at a different dimension of human and wildlife interaction, the ways in which hunting wildlife presented a disease risk. So 75% of emerging infectious diseases are zoonotic, meaning they're transferred from animals to humans. Everything like SARS, avian influenza, Ebola, HIV, all of these major pandemics are actually started in animal host and transferred to humans. But the most interesting thing that I learned was really from local people. The image behind me is a local rendition of the Kalanur. She is a part of their local spiritual animist pantheon. She's always envisioned in the same way as a dwarf with long hair and long fingernails and backwards-facing feet with her heel pointing forward and her toes pointing backwards so that when she walks, no one can track and find her. But she does appear in people's dreams, and what she tells them in those dreams is which animals to have a taboo for. And so she can, in many ways, be seen as a conservation spirit because she's telling certain people what to not eat, what wildlife species should be protected. And yet what she really is a health spirit. Because in those dreams, she's giving messages like, don't eat this particular type of wildlife because your skin will change color. You'll bleed from your eyes, you'll bleed from your ears, or you'll die. And all of these symptoms are indicative of zoonotic disease transfer. And so I got very interested to see whether or not there was actually a relationship between this traditional epidemiological knowledge and what was actually there as a present disease risk. And what I found through surveying 1,200 households over the past 10 years was that the number one most commonly tabooed wildlife species was the hedgehog tenrec. More than 50% of the population had a taboo for the hedgehog tenrec. And although these stories have been passed on for generations, what we found was that just last year there was a discovery that the bubonic plague is present in the hedgehog tenrec, and that they have this kind of immunity to the bubonic plague, and so it consistently spills over into human populations and wildlife populations and rodent populations and presents a disease risk. And if you've been following the news, in October of last year, Madagascar experienced the largest epidemic outbreak of bubonic plague since the Middle Ages. And so I just think there's a tremendous amount that we can learn through local knowledge. So what happens now? We know for two reasons that wildlife consumption is bad. It presents this terrible risk to endemic wildlife populations. It presents a tremendous infectious disease risk to local humans. And yet it provides this critical source of nutrition to local people. So where do we go? We've decided to implement a sustainable chicken husbandry project. And this is a good idea for several different reasons. Number one is that I've done a taste preferences study looking at 23 different species of wildlife and 10 species of domesticated meats. And across the board, chicken is their number one taste preference. So not everything tastes like chicken. The second is that using this pervasive and complex taboo system across the board, no one has a taboo for chicken. And so if we're looking at a population intervention that's applicable to everyone, chicken is really the answer. And wildlife species are less preferred and also less expensive. So if we can develop ways to make chickens more productive, it could reduce the price and almost naturally wean people away from wildlife and into chicken. The problem is that there's Newcastle disease. This is a pathogen that wipes out 80 to 100% of the chicken flocks seasonally. So we just received funding from the Norvig Family Foundation a few weeks ago, actually. And it will import a vaccine from Malaysia, subsidize its costs, we'll get extension agents that will be teaching people about biosecurity measures and husbandry conditions, and hopefully be able to really tackle this problem on a local scale. So the case study that I've mentioned is not operating in isolation. It's part of a larger effort called HEAL, Health and Ecosystems Analysis of Linkages. It's a program that's based at WCS. I've recently become the director as of January. It's a 25-institution consortium that partners academic, NGO, and governmental organizations together to tackle this data gap. It's very intuitive that the environment and health is linked, and yet the evidence base is very weak. What I see is a very natural transfer from the terrestrial system into the marine system to look at the ways in which marine conservation through no-take zones, seasonal closures, or gear restrictions can protect biodiversity but also increase the productivity of fish stocks. This increased productivity doesn't stay within the bounds of the marine protected area but spills over into adjacent communities. And we want to measure empirically the ways in which there are nutritional benefits, livelihood benefits, health benefits that arise from marine conservation so that we don't think of it as an environmental intervention. We can frame conservation as a public health intervention. So in closing, I just want to say that I really found this extraordinary place in Madagascar, but I also found it in my backyard. And more I discover about myself, the more and more I see that these experiences were entirely parallel. That as I began to look through local people's eyes and see how they really saw the forest as benefiting their health, we too are receiving a very certain type of health benefit from the areas that surround us. And so I just want to say that exploration can really take us far afield. And yet I think the most important thing that we can do is take what we find in those explorations and make sure that we take it home. Thank you.